In this segment, we'll talk about how to derive the two-point Gauss quadrature rule of integration. To be able to understand the two-point Gauss quadrature rule derivation, what we should do is we should start with the trapezoidal rule and derive it by the method of undetermined coefficients. So we already know that this is the trapezoidal rule. And what we're going to do is we are going to use the method of undetermined coefficients by saying that, hey, I want my integral to be approximately calculated by taking the function value at a, multiplying it by some coefficient c1, let's suppose, finding the value of the function at b and multiplying by some coefficient c2 or a weight, as they may call it. So c1 and c2 are the weights, and a and b are the quadrature points. Now the thing is that how do we derive the trapezoidal rule by using the method of undetermined coefficients as follows, is that we're going to say that this formula is going to give me the exact value if I integrate a function like this one, a straight line. So I would like the integral of this function to come out to be the same as I would get by my exact integral calculus knowledge as I would get by using this particular formula. So what that means is that if I was going to calculate this integral exactly from a to b, what I would get is as follows. I would get a naught x plus a1 x squared by 2 here, lower limit a, upper limit b, and this will be a naught times b minus a plus a1 times b squared minus a squared by 2. That's what I would get. So if that is the case, from using the exact integration, what would I get if I use the formula which I have started with, the assumption that, hey, it would be c1 times the value of the function at a plus c2 times the value of the function at b. So I have c1 times the value of the function at a plus c2 times the value of the function at b. So the function is a0 plus a1x. Remember that. The function which we assume for which we'll get the same value from integral calculus as we'll get from the formula is a0 plus a1x, a straight line, with a0 and a1 being arbitrary values. So I'll get a0 plus a1 times a, because the value of x is a at the argument a. Same thing here with c2 times the value of a0 plus a1 times b. Now, this is what I get from the formula. What I had previously is what I get from the exact integration, and I want those to be the same. So from the previous formula, I got a naught times b minus a plus a1 times b squared minus a squared by 2. And that I want to be equal to this quantity here, c1 times a naught plus a1a plus c2 times a naught plus a1 times b. However, I have now two unknowns, c1 and c2, but I only have one equation. How do I go about trying to figure out, hey, how will I be able to get two questions and two unknowns? Is as follows. I'm going to collect the terms of a0. So it'll be c1 plus c2. It'll be this term and this term. I'll collect the terms of a1, which is here and here. It'll be c1a plus c2b. And the only way this can be exactly equal to this for any value of a0 and a1 is if the coefficients of a0 here is same as the coefficient of a0 here, if the coefficient of a1 is same as the coefficient of a1 here. So what that means is c1 plus c2 is equal to b minus a, and c1a plus c2b is equal to b squared minus a squared by 2. So since that is the case, if you solve these two equations, and you can do it by simple algebra, you'll get c1 is equal to b minus a divided by 2, and you'll get c2 is equal to b minus a divided by 2. And hence, our approximate formula will be integral of a to b f of x dx is approximately c1, which is b minus a divided by 2, times the value of the function at a, plus c2, times the value of the function in B. And that's the same as the trapezoidal rule. So let's see how this is related to the derivation of the two-point Gaussian quadrature rules as follows. This is what we started for the trapezoidal rule. That's how we developed the trapezoidal rule, by saying that, hey, this is my this is going to be my formula. What values of c1 and c2 should I choose so that I can get an approximate value for an integral? So we said, hey, let it at least give us the exact value for a straight line, and we're able to find c1 and c2. What the two-point Gaussian quadrature rule now is different, is that it's now saying that, hey, we don't need to necessarily fix a and b. We're going to choose them to be x1 and x2, with, of course, the restrictions that a has to be between, x1 has to be between a and b, and of course x2 has to be between a and b. And if we, under these restrictions of x1 and x2 being between a and b, can we find out what the values of c1, x1, c2, x2 can be so that we can approximate the value of the integral? But look at this. We have now been able to obtain four choices. One, two, three, and four choices. Here, when we were deriving the trapezoidal rule, we had only two choices, c1 and c2, because we had fixed the quadrature points to be a and b. How does it really matter? Because now what I can do is, if I use this, which is the starting point of the derivation of the two-point Gaussian quadrature rule, that's where it starts. It starts right here. What I can do now is that I can say that is exact for a third order polynomial. Why can I make that statement? Is because I have four choices, and hence I can choose a third order polynomial, because when I equate the coefficients of a0, a1, a2, and a3, I'll get four equations, and I have four unknowns. I could only do a0 plus a1x in the trapezoidal rule because it only had two unknowns. So we follow the same procedure as we use for the method of undetermined coefficients for the trapezoidal rule. We have this as our third order polynomial, and this is the exact value of the integral, and this is what we get once we put a and b in it. So that is what we get from the exact integral of the function of the third order polynomial. Let's go and see what we get from using the formula. In using the formula, which is what we started with, f of x is equal to this, the third order polynomial. That's what we chose. So what is the value of c1 times f of x1 plus c2 times f of x2? It would be c1, which is right here, times the value of this particular function at x1. And the only difference is that instead of x, we have x1. Plus c2 times the value of the function at x2. So that's what we get by using the formula itself. Now, just like in the method of undetermined coefficients for trapezoidal rule, what I did was I collected the terms of a0, a1, a2, and a3. I'll do the same here. If you look at the terms of a0 here are c1 and c2, which is right here. The terms of a1 are c1 times x1 plus c2 times x2, which is right here, and so on and so forth. And why are we collecting these terms of the a0, a1, a2, and a3? So here what we have is, this is what I got by using the exact integration of a third order polynomial. This is what I get by using the formula c1 times f of x1 plus c2 times f of x2, and I want both of them to be the same. And since a0, a1, a2, and a3 are arbitrary real numbers, we didn't put any kind of restrictions on the values of the coefficients of the third order polynomial. What that simply implies is that although you might see only one equation and four unknowns, we actually have four equations and four unknowns. Why is that so? Because the coefficient of a0 has to be the same. That gives you this. The coefficient of a1 has to be the same. That gives us this. The coefficient of a2 has to be the same as this. That gives you this equation. And the coefficient of this equation, this a3 here, a sub 3, is supposed to be the same coefficient of a sub 3 here, and that gives you this equation. So that's how you are able to find out these four equations. Now keep in mind that these four equations which you have four equations, four unknowns. All of these four equations are nonlinear in nature except for this one, because here is one unknown multiplied by another, and here's one unknown multiplied by the square of another unknown, and so on and so forth. So all of these four equations which you have here are nonlinear in nature except for the first one. So you basically have a set of simultaneous nonlinear equations. So there's a possibility of no solution, possibility of a unique solution, possible of multiple finite number of solutions, or possibility of infinite number of solutions. And as you will see that there are only two solutions for this set of equations in the next slide. So we have four simultaneous nonlinear equations, and the two acceptable solutions which we get are these. And these are the only two acceptable solutions. You might say, hey, we have multiple solutions, but actually this solution here is same as this solution here, because these x1 and x2 are interchangeable, because c1 and c2 are interchangeable, because c1 is b minus a divided by 2 and c2 is b minus a divided by 2. If you take these values of c1, c2, x1, x2 right here, you'll get exactly the same formula as you'll get from this solution. So actually we have only one solution once we look at the integral formula. Yes, we have two solutions from the nonlinear equations, but so far as the formula which we have for integration, we have simply one solution, where c1 is this, c2 is this, x1 is this, and x2 is this. So writing in the compact form, this is what we started with. We were able to find c1 equal to this, x1 equal to this, c2 equal to this, and x2 equal to this. And if you are now, you should be able to find the approximate value of integral by using this particular formula by the two-point Gaussian quadrature rule. What this simply implies is that if you take a third order polynomial, any third order polynomial less, and you integrate it by using exact integration, or if you start using this particular formula, you'll get exactly the same result. For any other function which is not a third order polynomial less, you'll get an approximate value. So keep in mind that although we are using the third order polynomial to figure out what the values of c1, x1, c2, and x2 are, those are just simply used to derive the method. You can use it for any function you want to. Yeah, surely the answer which you'll get will be approximate. And that's the end of this segment.